no God like Jehovah.
Yes. Hallelujah.
We can search all over. We still can't find nobody like our God.
Okay.
Amen. Thank God for you being in the house of the Lord. You could have chosen to be anywhere else. But I believe God put your heart to be at this place on this morning.
Yeah.
I realize it is the pastoral first lady appreciation.
Yeah.
But even in that, if it had not been for the Lord, you may have chosen to go somewhere. But I don't know about you, but I appreciate the words of David. I was glad when they said, let us go into the house. So Lord, I bring you greetings from Anchorage, Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church, where I serve as the auxiliary pastor. Pastor that I remember, Dr. Arnold E. Patterson, senior pastor, amen. Everybody know that name. If you hang around or ask you any amount of time, you will know Pastor Patterson.
Yeah.
He does send his love, he says send his care. And we're grateful to be here. Paul was born here, good kids, all of you God's people. To my wife, amen, who traveled with me. Yes, the Reverend Mildred Parker. Yes, thank God for me. Into our honorees today. Come on, watch the video. Let's just honor this man and this woman. So that is why we gathered today, to say thank you, to appreciate them, to say we love them, to say thank you for the ministry, the message that you give us. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the invitation to come. When Pastor Blackburn called me, he was down to preach Pastor's 46th pastoral anniversary.
Yeah.
We were down there eating, I believe. And he pulled me aside and said, I may call you. Come up to Fairbanks. He did not call me. I'm ready to make a trip. Now, I did not know was going to be the pastoral appreciation. Amen. So when he shared those few words with me, my heart just dropped. So it is a humbling experience to be invited to such an occasion. I will not belabor the time. I've chosen to use the text that was given to me and to use the words, the theme. Amen. So if you will, if it's your custom to stand, to sit, we're going to read this scripture. I'm going to read it from the King James Version. I understand on the program it's in the Message Version. But I'm going to read it from the King James Version. Just read it until you hear it. And then we will see what the Lord has to say. 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, verse 12 says, and we beseech you, brother, to know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Amen. Amen. The Lord bless the reading here and do it. Remain seated in the presence of God. Our text today says that we are, it is a time to remember your gift.
Yeah.
Time to remember your gift.
Yes,
the Bible says there is a time for everything under the heavens. Today is a time to remember the gift.
Yes.
The gift that God has given you. I was looking at this and I said, it's not plural. The word gift is not plural. And as I thought about that theme, the Bible says when man and woman come together in holy matrimony, they become one. So it is appropriate then to say your gift. For these two are one. Not only in the Lord, not only with each other, but also with you. Any of us who are leaders in the church, deacons, ministry leaders, if we look over our lives, we would really think about the thing and ask ourselves, why God would choose us? I don't want to take time today to start raising hands, and it's not testimony time, so I will not have anyone speak on that. But if you think about it for a moment, why would God want to choose us? Think of this. We are wretched people. We are disobedient. We are unruly. We don't listen. We want to do our own thing. Yet God says, I choose you. And you know, we can take courage today because we are not in bad company.
All right.
For there are many down through the years that God has chosen to use in spite of who they were and who they are. Just go with me for a moment. Abraham was too old. And yet God used him. Moses was a murderer. Yet God used him. Miriam was a gossip. But yet God said yes to him. Jacob was a liar. But yet God said, Noah was a drunk. But God. David was an adulterer. But God said. Samson was self-centered. But God. Jeremiah was depressed and suicidal. But yet God. But yet God said, Jonah ran from God. But yet God, think about it. Mary was late. Didn't want to do anything. Paul was a murderer. Timothy had low self-esteem. Peter was afraid of death. But God said yes to these men.
Yeah.
realize that a church needs strong leaders.
Yeah.
I think I need to say that again.
All right.
A church needs strong leaders.
Yes.
A leader that stays true and faithful to the mission and ministry of the Lord, then God can begin to work in his life. One that does not get caught up in the customs and the trials of the day, but stays faithful to the word of God and says, I will use you in spite of it. One that says yes when the world is saying no. That's a leader. Yeah. One that sticks to the scripture that teaches and admonishes and instructs you in the word of God. That's a leader. One that seeks to bring back the fractured friendship between you and God. One that tries to be faithful in every way possible. One that looks at the ruptured relationship between you and man and said, I can help you in that.
Yeah,
right. That is a God leader.
Yeah.
God needs such men and women as such. So on today, as we appreciate this pastor, this first lady, I want you to hold on to something. It's not because of who they are, but it's because of the call on their life.
Yeah.
I want to encourage you today, I want to challenge you today, that it does not matter what they do or don't do, because God said it. It's alright. It's alright. Everything is all right. When they challenge you and charge you, everything is all right.
Yes.
For the Lord says, yes, to this man and this one. Hallelujah. Now I'm looking at my tablet here, and that thing done went off on me. That is. Failed to do something. I failed to put it on, stay on. Listen, because of all this that goes on, it is no reason that the Bible tells us to honor, to respect, to serve, to care for, and to submit to our leaders. So if you will, go with me. Go with me as we look at this text that is before us.
All right.
I want to take this text, I want to take it apart so that you can read it and apply it to everyday life. Amen.
All right.
Keep your Bibles open, because we will not be going anywhere else but right here. I do not jump throughout the scripture unless I found to be guilty, not saying what's in the Bible. Keep your Bible open.
Right.
Look at the text. The text tells us, first of all, he says, I beseech you. And then I like this word here, brother. Now you know, whenever you see the word brother in the text, is talking about church
folk. All right.
Somebody say church folk. It is talking about the church people. Right. Not talking about the world. Not talking about those on the job. It's talking about us that are in the household of faith.
Yeah.
Paul opens this letter with an earnest appeal.
Uh-huh.
He said, I'll beseech you.
Yeah.
Whenever you see these words that Paul writes, Paul says this often, I beseech you, in other words, This thing is real. This thing has to be real to you. And not only that, you need to pay attention. Because what follows this is of utmost importance. He said, I beseech you, brother, these are church folk, go in the church that are living, supposed to be according to the word of God. And then it says, I want you to know them which labor among you, look at this, and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you. Now that conjunction there means there's two things going on right here. So look at this. I want you to know this. Let me just pause right there for a moment as we talk about the appreciation. Sir, appreciate your pastor and first lady. How much do you know? Oh, get quiet. How much do you really know them at labor? How much have you spent time with them?
Right. front of you. And the pastor, the brother man said, Sister So-and-so, you might not want to go that direction, Brother So-and-so. You might not want to go that way. And if I'm not careful, man, I don't want to listen to that money. If I don't want to pick the godly counsel, then I may fall in the ditch. And you know how some of us are. As soon as we get in trouble, we come running to the church. Fix what's going on in my life. And the church said, why did you leave? In the first place.
Right.
If we would take the instruction, understand that it is a divine employment and it is a divine engagement that the Lord has put in place. We can't do nothing to it. We can't do nothing against it. But we can know one thing for sure. God has our best interest at heart. He has our best interest. He don't want us going astray.
Right.
So he gives us a passionate wife.
Yeah.
He don't want us uninformed. So he gives us a pastor. And why he don't want us to go to a place where there is no return, he gives us a pastor. And why?
talking too much stuff now.
Respect their time. When they ask you to be in the place where you're supposed to be. You're supposed to be. You want to esteem them very highly in love. But then look at why are you esteeming them? It's not because of who they are. Because when we look back over the life, and nobody want to go there, we look back over the life, and we held them to the life before Christ, we never lift them anywhere. But look at what it says. It says, for their work. Say.
what I want to say to you, Keith.
We ought not be arguing with the pastor and wife.
Yes, sir.
Preach.
We ought not be saying, am I in the right place? Was I supposed to be here? We ought not be saying, I ain't doing that, pastor.
I know it's quiet. It's quiet. But I'm in the Bible. That's why I told you, don't move your Bible. This is the word of God.
It says, be at peace amongst yourself. In other words, can't we all just get along? We don't have to be people that always got all amongst each other. Especially not the pastor, first of all. I told somebody one time, I had this ministry, I was counseling with this ministry. Really wasn't counseling, we could have a conversation. And came in, and I was working with him, and word had got out of my congregation about this individual. Doing something that should not have been done. Said, I need to talk to him. So we sat down and had a discussion. This is what this individual said. He said, y'all don't do stuff right now. Y'all don't use the Bible right. Don't sing the song right. And then finally they said, and I don't preach of this. I looked at him and I said this. He said, two things. First, I said, Dr. Patterson is the pastor of this church. And if we don't ever get a chance to preach, we already fine with it. Yeah. Yeah. If I never get an opportunity to stand in that pulpit at Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church, I ought to be all right with it. Because God didn't call me to be the pastor there yet. He's the pastor. He's the chief shepherd. He's the preacher. He's the one that stands and proclaims the gospel of Jesus Christ to his flock. And as a minister, we ought to be okay with it. That's what I told him one. That was the first thing I told him. Then the second thing I told him, looking flat in his eyes, and I said, because we don't do things the way you see us doing, brother, you might need to find another church. You know what? He's not there today. Let me tell you, when they talk about being at peace amongst yourself, if you don't like what's going on, Pastor Blackburn, oh Lord, you call me out. If you don't like what's going on, all day long. No, not until the ministry is done. Why? scripture is done.
Yes.
Be at peace with one another. That word peace carries another definition. I gotta get out of here and look at that car. That word peace carries another definition. There's peace amongst me and you. Yeah, there's peace. Peace. We're at peace. We're getting along. We see it eye to eye. We may not agree with everything, but we're able to move forward in minutes. But then there's another definition for this word peace in the Bible. And that word peace in the Bible also says you have to be at peace with God. Uh-oh. And you know what? That's why Jesus coming in. And well, he's always been through it, but this is where he really comes in. See, if you're not at peace with God, if you're always, as the Bible told Paul when before he met Jesus, why are you always kicking against the priest? Why are you always fighting against me? Why are you not doing what I need you to do? If you're not at peace with God, you're not going to be at peace with the pastor and person. And if you have not decided within yourself that this life that I'm living in the world is not a life I want to keep on living,
yes, sir.
And I need to come on the Lord's side. Somebody say, who's on the Lord's side? Yeah, I got to come on the Lord's side and be at peace with God. Listen, it's all right. If you want to go there, it's all right to be in upheaval with the pastor and first lady. Because they don't have a heaven or hell to put you in. But when you're not in peace with God, God has the authority to tell you where you can go. And because he loves you so much, he'll make sure you get there in one piece. If you want to go to heaven, guess what?
Yeah,
all right. Dad can't do it?
Yeah.
Sin definitely. know that I will come myself. That I will be a guide and light for the people of the earth. Yeah. That I will be their one and only example to let them know that this is a divine appointment that I have today. Yeah. He will set men and women in the place of authority. He will give them every instruction they need to give to the people. But he said, before I send them, I gotta come myself and show them the way. I gotta be the example for them. I gotta let them know no matter what you do against me, I'm gonna love them. When they lied on Jesus, guess what he did? He looked at them. Father, forgive them.
Yes, sir.
But they know not what they do. When they been spit on them, when they put a crown of thorn on him, when they put him into a trial, he didn't say anything. He didn't say, no, sit down, leave them to the angels to burn them up, to kill them, to take them out. No, he said, I gotta keep on going.
Yeah.
And when it was all over, that time came for him to reach his destiny. He went into the Garden of Gethsemane. In human form, he found himself wrapped up, tied up in this fleshly, this fleshly desire, and saying, Lord, I really don't want to go to the cross, but if I don't go to the cross, they'll never know how much I love you. So he came to the point three times and said, Father, not my will, but your will be done. He walked on out the garden and looked at his disciples who fell asleep three times. Told him, don't worry about it, boys. My hour is done. Now it's time for me to go and see the Lord. It's time for me to go and do what I came here to do. They came and took my Jesus. Marched him up a hill called Calvary. And there on that cross, the Bible says he died for each one of us, all because of love. All because he cared. All because he wanted to see the best for each and every one of us. All because this pastor's wife is sitting in this church, Mount Pleasant, at the church of Fairbanks, Alaska, for 11 years to serve as your shepherd, as your leader. He hung there on that cross. And the Bible says he hung there all night long. And he died on that cross. The Bible says before he died, he looked at him crying. In the crowd and didn't see too many of his disciples because they decided they wanted to go back home.
Yeah.
They didn't know which way to go. I wonder how many of us gonna go back home. After we have appreciated, after we have lifted up, after we have esteemed our pastor and wife, don't go back home. Stay at the foot of the cross and serve. Right. And we look at us, the crowd. They see it about his disciples, but John sat in there.
Uh-huh.
And said, now this is your mother.
Yeah.
This is your son. And I'm going to take care of where I'm going because guess what? I got to go. And the Bible says he hung there. He hung there and put his head in the locks of his shoulder. And he died on that cross that Friday evening. He died on that cross for my sin and for your sin. He died on that cross so that one day I would be able to live. He died on that cross and one day death would not be able to touch me. And the Bible says they took him down. Laid him in a borrowed tomb.
Yeah.
And he stayed there one night.
Yeah.
He stayed there two nights.
Yeah.
But early Sunday morning, on that Thursday morning, the Bible said he got up with all power in his hand. And one day he's coming back. He's coming back for a church that is obedient, a church that loves his pastor and wife, a church that serves in ministry, a church that does what he called him to do.
Jesus
has sent you this pastor, this first lady, and he calls you today to honor them, to appreciate them, to serve when they instruct you to.
Yes.
To keep your life holy before the Lord. Don't let today be the only day that you appreciate this pastor and this first lady. But do it every day. For every day, Jesus watches for our souls.
And one day, people of God, he's coming back. And you better be ready. But you're sure they'll seek the accountability of everyone else. We are to esteem him. Listen, they're no better than any one of us. But they are God's servants. And they've been called to this position. I charge Mount Pleasant Baptist Church today. I charge you to do these 5 things. You want to appreciate this pastor, this person. I've given them to you already, but I want to say it again. Protect their time. You want to appreciate them? Protect their time. Don't let any and everything take away their time. That's why leaders are in the church. That's why our organization is in place. Protect their time. Pray for them. Continue. Always keep them in prayer. Always. Pay attention when they speak to you. For they're instructing you. God lives with them. Provide for their needs. They have needs just like everyone else. Provide for them. And the last one, please them and serve them. Find your place in ministry. Find your place where God has called you. Watch God lift you up. Just as he said he would. Bow your head. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for your death that you allow me to do what you ask me to do. Pray that this message would not go out and turn cold, but that it would touch the hearts and minds of you. That it would encourage, challenge, charge them to be like a business of the kingdom of God. I pray for this pastor. I pray for this first lady.
Yes.
Thank you for letting me. Thank you for allowing them to stand on the wall, proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for allowing them to be your servant. Now I pray for this congregation that on this day they appreciate you for the work they do. Lift them up in prayer. Stand with them. Encourage them. But then, God, I pray that this not be the only day, but every day going forward, that this church would appreciate this pastor and wife. That they would indeed be the good sheep in this pasture. Bless you, God. Your word. Bless be your soul. May you be glorified in everything we say and do. Let your will be done. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Lord. Amen. 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 God bless you.